When talking about migrants and talking about refugees, people always like to say, well, why don't they stay at your house then? Or just like host them in your house. And basically what I have to say to that is, hi everyone, welcome or welcome back. Something that I want to talk about today is climate refugees. And I want to make a video on it. So right now, I don't know why I just did that. But basically there's a difference between internally displaced people, migrants, refugees, etc. So there is a difference between asylum seekers, migrants, internally displaced people, and refugees. So I talk about that more in my other video, just giving you a definition of all the differences. But basically, refugees have an international designation by all of the bodies. And what refugees are people who have fled persecution based on, you know, their sex, their gender, their sexual orientation, their religion, also war and violence. All refugees were at first asylum seekers, and then they get their application processed and it's basically confirmed that they had to deal with these things, and then they are given the designation as refugee. But not all asylum seekers end up with that designation. So right now, we are in a situation where there is climate change, whether you believe it is man-made or, you know, natural processes of the earth or whatever. This video is not here to debate that, because climate change is real, it's happening, sea levels are rising, the temperature of the earth is rising, and this is just isn't up for debate anymore. And so now we're at the point where we have to figure out what to do about it. And of course, a lot of the politicians are talking about, you know, how to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and how to, you know, basically go green a little bit more, which is great, but we have already caused damage. And basically there are estimates that there's going to be somewhere between 25 million and a billion climate refugees. Interestingly, climate refugees do not have a designation from the United Nations or from any international body at this point. Nobody is recognized as a climate refugee. Right now they are just called climate migrants. In my opinion, I think that they should be recognized as refugees, and I will lay out all of my reasons during this video. Currently, the United Nations take on it is if they are forced to move inland or to another area due to rising sea levels or terrible natural disasters, if they end up moving into an area where there is like war, violence, or they end up facing persecution, then they could become eligible for refugee status, but not until then. And in my opinion, that's kind of silly, because they can't control the rising sea levels. And also, there is no need to like re-traumatize these people. They have to leave their homes because of a natural disaster, and then they have to go into an area, and then they have to be persecuted before they can be called a refugee. It just seems like really backwards to me. So hopefully this is something that is going to be worked on. It's something that I hope to work on in the future. There was a case in the island nation of Kiribati. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, so I'm sorry if I'm not. But basically, they're gonna go underwater. The entire island nation is going to end up going underwater. And one of the residents there applied for essentially refugee status in New Zealand for him and his family. It ended up being denied. And the reason was because he was not in imminent danger. Basically, because, you know, the island's not going to go under for another 10 or 20 years. With the amount of climate refugees that there are going to be, so I gave you the figures 25 million to a billion. The most commonly cited figure is 200 million people. So if you have 200 million people who need to move, it only seems like it makes sense to start slowly moving them instead of waiting until there is some terrible disaster and everyone has to move all at once. But I'll also get into that a little bit more later. There are some island nations, you know, without hills. Kiribati doesn't have any hills. It's literally just like a flat island land. There are a couple islands who have been completely wiped off the map. Now, they were not inhabited islands, but it just goes to show you that eventually it's going to be an inhabited island that gets affected. Tuvalu is another island nation that's facing a lot of problems from this. Tuvalu has actually purchased land on Fiji, in the mountainous areas of Fiji, which is also another island nation. And the Tuvalu people will be able to relocate or move to that island nation of Fiji and live in that area that the Tuvalu government has purchased for them, so that when they have to flee due to their island literally going underwater. Luckily, the Fiji president is, you know, welcoming to the people from Tuvalu, and, you know, basically says that they're welcome here and they're gonna work it out together. However, that's just like a temporary fix. There's so many temporary fixes and so many band-aids that I feel government is putting on this instead of actually trying to deal with what is coming. But it's really interesting when we are looking at, you know, Fiji is willing to take in all of these people, and it's a pattern that poorer countries are actually the ones who take in more refugees currently. So currently, 39% of refugees are hosted in just 5 countries. Those 5 countries are Turkey, which hosts 3.6 million refugees. These aren't climate refugees, by the way. These are like mostly Syrian refugees. Colombia, who hosts 1.8 million refugees. Actually, they're probably mostly hosting the refugees from Venezuela. Pakistan, hosting 1.4 million refugees. Uganda, hosting 1.4 million refugees from other African nations, and Germany actually at hosting 1.1 million refugees. So you see here, Turkey is a relatively low-income country, Colombia, Pakistan, Uganda, and they are actually like footing the bill and welcoming in the most refugees. There are going to be a lot of people fleeing where they live. That's just a fact. Probably about 200 million. And that is with the damage that we have already done to the environment. Even if we went carbon neutral today, because basically what we've already put out is still accumulating, global temperatures would still rise 0.6 degrees Celsius, so I think that's like 1.1 Fahrenheit, even if we stop today. So what we need to do is figure out a plan for these 200 million people, while at the same time mitigating that number so it doesn't get all the way up to 1 billion. Now, there are some island nations which are owned by other countries. For example, like the United States has American Samoa, Northern Mariana Islands, U.S. Virgin Islands, Puerto Rico, Guam, and I think that's it. And so they'd be able to come to the mainland. If something happened to Hawaii, those people would be able to come to the mainland. If something happened in New Orleans, Louisiana, as what happened with Hurricane Katrina, like, those people can move within the United States freely. Floridians can move within the United States freely. And they have the luxury of having a very large country to move about in. Most countries aren't as big as the United States. And honestly, like, most of the United States is pretty livable, even the Midwest. And a lot of countries are a lot smaller, and people don't have the luxury of moving around within the country. They don't have the luxury of staying in their country to try to get away from these disasters. Like, they will have to move countries, and it's not because they want to. Most refugees actually don't want to leave their country. And so when you think about it, like, I didn't choose to be born in the United States as much as someone didn't choose to be born in North Korea, as much as someone didn't choose to be born in Tuvalu. And so it just seems like, I guess, not fair. It only seems natural that we should also let them in. Like, we're not any better than someone who happened to be born on an island nation. Nobody chose that. But I will say that this is going to be a very contentious political issue in the future, as I see it. Because, I mean, you have the, what, like, couple million refugees coming from Syria, and that caused a huge crisis in Greece and Europe and Germany, and it's a big reason behind Brexit. Obviously, it's a lot more nuanced, but one of the reasons was the United Kingdom didn't want the European Union to have the ability to just send all the refugees there when they arrived on European shores. So it's going to be a big problem. I feel like the sooner governments start realizing that we're gonna have to figure out how to distribute 200 million people around, the better. Because if we wait until there is a ginormous disaster and there's lots of death and lots of destruction, and we have to get people out in an emergency basis and get them resettled somewhere. Or we could start moving some people every year to a different country. That way they have time to establish themselves and get a job, and it's not one giant emergency at once. This is a topic that I have so many thoughts about, and I feel like I'm kind of all over the place just because there's so much that I know and want to say and want to share on this topic. So I hope I've covered most of my bases. Oh, actually, there is one more thing. So with the mass migrations that we're going to see, and people basically concentrated on islands or near shores, like for example, Bangladesh is a very, very poor country, and a lot of the people live in slum areas which are near the water, and they are literally going to get washed out pretty quickly. Lots of slum areas of the Manila, Philippines, and so many other countries are on the water. And those people are already very concentrated in where they live, and there's going to be less land that people are able to live on, right? Because some land is going to be quite literally too dry. There's going to be no ability to maintain food or water there. So people are going to have to leave, and the people are going to have to leave the land that gets flooded with water, and it basically ceases to exist because it goes underwater. So with this mass migration, what's going to happen is people are going to end up concentrating all together in more places. We're going to be moving 200 million people into a certain few countries. They're most likely going to settle in cities, which will make cities even more populated, which will create more vectors for when we have another pandemic. And there will be another one. Scientifically, there will be another one, especially with climate change, because basically what you have is less food, less water, which will lead to increased sickness because people won't have proper nutrients, people won't be able to wash their hands, there's going to be more bacteria. And then on top of that, people will start eating things that aren't meant to be eaten, like, I don't know, bats, or a random, you know, animal that hasn't been consumed by humans, because they are literally starving, so they're gonna kill an animal and eat it, and I don't blame them. But then that can create a disease, which people can host and pass from person to person, like Ebola, I believe, was passed by like monkeys or gorillas. So when people come into more close contact with those animals, it will create another pandemic. I mean, that's just like basic science. And then when people are more populated together, they are going to be, you know, transmitting it a lot faster to a lot more people. So what can I do to help? I have all this information, how do I help? I would say, for now, do your part to shop green and sustainably. Write to your representatives, your senators, encourage them to support green initiatives. If you are in the United States, then, you know, whatever you call your representatives, I'm not sure. Start petitions for companies, make videos, share them, get actual facts and statistics and share them with people. Get that information out there, lead by example. Obviously there's more to it, but you know, this is a start, and I would just say to encourage people to realize that humanity is humanity no matter what country they're born in. And I really think when people can reconcile that in their head, it'll just make more sense to them. And a common comeback, I guess, that people like to use when talking about migrants, you know, right now at the United States, it's like the Texas-Mexican border. When talking about migrants and talking about refugees, people always like to say, well, why don't they stay at your house then? Or just like host them in your house. And basically what I have to say to that is, bear with me because I've got a rant out here. This isn't about you or me. This is about humanity as a species. So are you telling me that you're more worried about your tax dollars than you are worried about humankind? When you fail to act and accept refugees, you're telling me that money is more important than people. They didn't choose to be born in Kiribati or Bangladesh or the Congo as much as I didn't choose to be born in the United States. What makes my life more valuable than theirs? What makes me more deserving of food and water and protection from climate threats? People don't deserve to be punished for their birthplace. Those of us born in developed nations didn't do anything to be here. It's not something that we somehow earned. What gives us the right to refuse climate refugees' entry and relegate them to a life of slow but certain death due to lack of water and food? If you think I'm being dramatic, open your eyes. water futures are being traded on the US stock market. Water. We're going to be in a water shortage by 2070. I'm probably still gonna be alive. If you have kids or grandkids, like, they're literally not gonna have water. And what gives us the right to refuse them entry and condemn them to die in their town or island that got completely flooded out? What are we gonna do? Repatriate them to a place that no longer exists? What gives us the right to play God with their lives while there's people in the United States living in their McMansions with enough unworn clothing to clothe entire villages? This isn't about America first. This isn't about China first, or Australia, or Denmark, or France. This is about humanity first. If in your soul you value money over hundreds of millions of lives, I feel sorry for you. It must be a sad life to live believing that other humans aren't worthy just because they weren't conceived and or born in the same country as you. How can you close your eyes to all of that human suffering? This isn't about Republican or Democrat. It worries me to know that greed has become so numbed to the point where people care more about what their net worth will be in 2030 than whether humanity will cease to exist in 2300.